Here comes the sun, doo 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 doo. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, doo-doo-doo-doo. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Little darling, the smile's returning to their faces. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, doo 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 doo. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Sun, 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 here it comes. Sun, 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 here it comes. Little darling, feel the ices slowly melting. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been clear. Here comes the sun, doo-doo-doo-doo. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Sun, 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 here it comes.
When the world changed and went into lockdown, my place of solace was at the top of a hill in the country. A long way from the road trips and gigs and more road trips and more gigs. It didn't take long before I was missing it all. No one could go more than 2 kilometers from their home, so with only mountains as an audience, I started to do what I do, play music. At first, it felt like singing into a void, but it made everything feel a little more normal, whatever that is, was, or will be. These concerts were my postcards from the edge, my way of expressing myself and singing the body electric. And it turned out that while I was out in the wilderness, I wasn't the only one feeling this way. People would respond with their messages, requesting songs, saying hello to loved ones in a foreign land, sharing stories of joy and sadness. It's this experience and these postcards from the edge that have inspired this new program. I can't speak for everyone, but I'm ready to get out, to meet people again, to chat, and find out how they got on and what got them through. That's what this show is all about, meeting real people and sharing their stories. And of course, there will be lots of music and crack along the way.
Hi, folks. And welcome to Postcards from the Edge. I'm reading your comments here. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you're all doing well. And thanks for tuning in. It's been a while. And thankfully, gigs have commenced again and things are creaking open, slowly but surely. So thanks to everyone for the sold-out shows everywhere. It's been great seeing you all again and singing with you again. Live music has never been so potent, and needless to say, the soul needs musical nourishment to make sense of the world now more than ever. And we have plenty of that on this show for you. The basic plan for this series is that each week we're going to examine a different theme, diversity and inclusion, youth on hold, pastimes, and of course this week it's isolation and community. So send us your emails, messages, TikToks, videos, carrier pigeons, poems, paintings. We want to hear from you if it's how you express yourself, and we want to see it and we want to hear you. And it can be anonymous if you prefer. Please use the hashtag JackLPostcard so we can find it on all the various different social media platforms. And well, you don't have to wait. This is live here now. We are recording, so message us now. I'm seeing your messages here. Hello to Kevin Whelan, Kerry Louise Darby, how you doing? Grace Ferry, how you doing? So here's, I have one I got earlier on, a postcard via Twitter from Jane O'Brien. Hi, Jane. Hey, she's a healthcare worker in Kildare. And her story, her postcard from the Edge is, my first part of the COVID story is that I worked through some of the saddest days our nursing home has ever been through. And then I was quite sick with COVID. On a personal level, our only daughter went on a two-week holiday and I haven't seen her since. That was 1 year and 20 days ago. So I don't know about postcards from the Edge, but it certainly took this mama to the edge. She is safe and happy and living her best life in Jersey along with one of my sons. I turned 50 in November. Happy birthday, Jane, and hope that my children can make it home by Christmas. So hope the first of these live streams goes fab for you. See you in the Spiegel Tent in Wexford. As always, thanks for the music and thanks for the support. Thanks a million, Jane. Well, thank God for all the technology we have. At least we can all stay in touch with each other like this. And I hope the family get back together soon. So thanks for that. So that's, if you can send in your stories like that, it'll all make sense. And you can send videos, whatever you like. Now, this may not be your standard concert, but don't worry, there will be plenty of music from our Postcards from the Edge performance space that away. Together we will meet some special guests and have some crack too. In fact, I'm about to wander next door and kick things off. This next song is one of the great Irish songs. I actually sang it in Jamaica at my sister's wedding. Hello to Jerry and Mark. And tonight it's just as poignant for me, because here in the Malt House in Strably, would you believe my great-grandfather used to work here? So I'm going to sing it for him and sing it for you. In the meantime, this is how you can get in touch.
Hi, this is Jack Lukeman, and I'm looking for your pandemic stories for my new web show, Postcards from the Edge. Please send me your poems, songs, messages, videos, or even just a request digitally. Tag your content online with hashtag JackLPostcards or send a message to any of the accounts shown here.
To post your postcards free of charge, send them to Postcards from the Edge, P.O. Box 13420, Free Post, FDN 7530, Dublin 2.
And my father
won't slight you for your lack of kind. And she stepped away from me and this she did say. I dreamt it, my dead love came in, so softly she entered, her feet made no din. She stepped away from me, and this she did say.
expected smaller queues in the summer.
Right.
But it's no different. In fact, like I could even say there's more because the school children would queue up as well now. Right. Even during school days, like they'd come and line up for school lunch.
And I'm back in the room. I'm just looking at your comments here. Thanks for all the comments, folks. Keep them coming. Keep your stories coming. I wanted to find out what things have been like on a grassroots level in the community. The Wheel is an organization that you may or may not have heard of, but they are a representative body for a lot of charitable organizations operating in Ireland. Welcome, Sarah and Claire. How you doing?
Hey, Jack. Thanks for having us.
How are you? Yeah, thanks for coming to our first show. I'm not a skilled interviewer, so bear with me. So Sarah, can you tell us a bit about The Wheel and the work you do?
I can indeed, I'd be happy to. So The Wheel are the National Association of Charities, Community and Voluntary Organisations and Social Enterprises in Ireland. So It's a big long title for a big, diverse, broad community of organisations and
umbrella,
groups.
It's an umbrella.
Exactly, it's umbrella body for all charities and community groups in Ireland. So we have almost 2,000 members now and they're situated in every community in Ireland as well as working internationally. And they're of every type and size that you can imagine, really. So it's everything from your large like household name charity right down to your community group that is just two people around a kitchen table. And they're doing all different types of work. They're working in areas like health and disability. They're working in housing and homelessness. They're also working in your local community garden, your local youth club, your local sports club, your local theatre. So essentially they are everywhere. Our members are present in all parts of your life and doing great work and have incredible impact on all of our lives.
Yeah, and it's all community based.
Yeah, Penny, that's right.
So Claire, can you tell us a bit about the partners involved, and we've devised this show with themes to go with the charities?
Yeah, so when we thought a little bit about the themes for the episodes, we thought about what really resonated throughout the pandemic.
So say tonight's episode is about isolation and community. So obviously a lot of us experienced profound isolation no matter what our circumstances were throughout the pandemic, but a lot of us also found community as well. So that might have been the fact that we were physically in our own neighborhoods for the first time in years, or it might have been that we found a community online, whatever that might have been. The other episodes that we'll be exploring are pastimes. So again, that was such a pivotal thing. A lot of people leaned into their pastimes and their hobbies during the pandemic. So whether that was a Zoom knitting circle or you picked up your guitar for the first time in 20 years. So it might have been revisiting an old one or discovering a new one. Diversity and inclusion is another, I think, important one to remember, that a lot of groups lost their visibility during the pandemic and they also lost their physical spaces to gather and meet. If you think of groups like LGBTQ people, migrants, travellers, a lot of these people didn't have the places that they normally go to gather, so they had to find new ways, and a lot of the organisations that The Wheel works with found ways of adapting for that. And then the last episode is Youth on Hold, and I think there's been a lot of focus, rightly so, on the elderly and the vulnerable and the people who really had to isolate significantly during the pandemic. But I think we need to really make space for all the young people who, you know, you have a very finite time in your life where you're young.
Of course,
And they gave up 18 months, 18 precious months of that to protect vulnerable people. Yeah. And a lot is said about young people being, you know, selfish or self-indulgent. But, you know, they gave up first job, first holiday, first kiss, first gig, you know, like
first festival, things like that.
All these huge things. And so across the four themes, they tie in really well with our members because they work in all these areas and all these spaces, and all of them had to adapt and evolve in the pandemic. So it'd be really interesting to explore those themes and see what they were doing.
Yeah, and this week's theme is isolation and community. Sarah, if you can speak a little bit about that and the work that's been done.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, there are so many stories from our sector and how they adapted overnight pretty much to change how their services and supports were present. And I suppose, you know, charities and community groups are at the heart of every community already. It's what made us so well placed to respond to something like the pandemic overnight like that. And I think it's everything from like the service delivery that was so vital. So delivering that meal to someone's door when they were cocooning or they were isolating for whatever reason, But it's also the chat that was had then, you know?
Human contact.
Absolutely,
yeah.
That connection, that is so important. I think we've really learned more than ever how important that connection was for all of us. So all those chats that were had across, you know, the garden wall and through windows and everything are really, you know, an important part of combating isolation and central to the work
so
that we
do. Online, but yeah.
That's it. I suppose in terms of stories, I do have favourites. Maybe I shouldn't, but there's one that always sticks out in my mind, which happened, kind of was replicated in lots of ways across the country, but it's all the way over in Achill Island, and Achill Tourism overnight rebranded and readapted what they were doing and became Achill Community Response. And they set up a phone line where you could order groceries to be delivered to someone's door. So what you had was a lot of adult children living in America or the UK or wherever, whose parents still lived on Achill Island. So they could call up, they could order groceries for their parents and know that it was being delivered. And while it was being delivered, somebody was having a chat with them, checking in on them. And it kind of developed and grew legs. And, you know, they were delivering like tailored orders of knitting supplies and gardening supplies. And, you know, no, I wanted that compost, not that compost. And, you know, leaving out the bins for them and stuff. But it was such a vital service for everybody in that scenario, not just the people who were receiving the service, let's say, but the, you know, their kids who were able to know that they were being supported, that when they were apart from their loved ones, that they knew someone was there. And even for, you know, the volunteers and the staff to be able to come together and go into action and respond to their local community like that is so important. It knits everybody together, you know,
It was a great side of it that brought communities back together.
Absolutely,
A silver lining. Claire, can you tell us a bit about the new campaign you're doing?
Yes, so it's launching at the end of October. It's a collaborative campaign called We Act, and it's all about celebrating the stories of Ireland's charities and community groups. So we, all these people, these volunteers, staff, all these organisations in every pocket, every corner of the country have been doing remarkable work over the last 18 months, but they've been doing it for the last 100 years. They continue to do it. And we want to celebrate them, we want to elevate their stories, and we want the public to know what they do every day, what their days are like, and how important their work is and what the impact of their work is. So we think it's really crucial that everyone understands and appreciates the work of community groups and charities. So we're looking forward to
now more than ever. Now more than ever, because they were the people that were out and about doing things when everybody else was locked up. These people were out. You know, they're the superheroes, I suppose, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Completely unsung heroes, and they do thankless jobs every day. And we're really excited to be able to celebrate them.
Yeah, well done to you. Give it up for Sarah.
Thank you.
So I was lucky enough over the last few weeks to meet one of the Wheels members, the Muslim Sisters of Éire, who are working at the coalface, as it were. So take a look at this. Hi, Lorraine.
Hi, Jack. How are you?
Lovely to be here with you.
Oh, thanks. You're welcome.
Where are you originally from yourself?
Born in Coolock.
Coolock. Yeah.
Left it when I was about six and raised in Kilbarrick.
Who's set up, the Muslim Sisters of Éire?
It was set up in 2010 by myself and another friend of mine, an Australian girl, Jasmina Kidd. And I think the reason why it was set up was in 2005 I became a Muslim and I started seeing pockets of racial kind of slurs telling me to go back to where you come from. Right. And I'm like, Coolock, do you know what I mean? Yeah. Where you want me to go, the north side of Dublin. Yeah. But it got me thinking, you know, if this is happening to me now, what's happening to my, you know, immigrant sisters and brothers or people who are of a different colour, creed, race or whatever. Mm-hmm. I remember being kind of feeling that I was stripped of my identity. I was no more Lorraine from the north side of Dublin. I was a foreigner. So my newfound faith was very new to me as well. Mm. And I needed to kind of empower myself in that and educate myself in that. Mm. And plus educate myself in Islamophobia, racial attacks. What can I do? How can I fit all these new pieces into my life?
Well, I'm here with Christine and Lorraine, and we're getting some donations from Tesco's, a variety of stuff. What kind of stuff do you provide?
Every Thursday when Lorraine comes, there'll be about 20 crates. And as I explained to everybody in there, Lorraine is on a mission. Every time she comes in, she's on a mission, gets the food, gets out, but she has to go to her next destination.
Absolutely, yeah.
And it's great for the staff because they can see then where the food goes to.
Yes,
so when they see something lying around, it's straight away off food cloud that goes into the depot. And
Nothing's wasted.
No, it's not. It's like a pieces of a jigsaw. And yes. We couldn't function without Tesco Rafarm is one piece, Tesco Kimmich is another piece, yeah. The Hilton, you know.
Yeah, people power.
It took 5 years and I studied my own religion. Mm-hmm. I went back to college and studied feminism and women's studies in UCD. Did some work with the domestic violence services, did some training with Rape Crisis Centre, mm-hmm. listening skills, all about empowering the woman. My vision was to have an organisation predominantly made up of women, mm-hmm. Muslim women. Mm-hmm. I had to be non-affiliated to any mosque and I had to be led by women. Mm. And the reason for that was to conquer the stereotype that was very much out there that Muslim women are very oppressed. They don't have a voice. They're in a male-dominant religion. They're voiceless and mm. they don't have any choice in life, where on the contrary, it was the total opposite.
Yeah.
So this is how Muslim Sisters of Éire was formed.
Hello.
Hi, Aisha. How you doing?
Hi, Jack. How are you?
Very good.
Welcome.
I'm here to examine your work.
Oh, you're here to work.
After you. Thanks for having me in your house.
Come on in.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Jack.
How are you all doing?
We're doing a super run 6 years now down outside the GPO, and pre-COVID we would have been feeding about 200 people a week. Now during COVID, and since the new kind of COVID poverty, as I call it, has been surfing its way to the very top of the realistic life that we're living in now, we've went from 200 meals a week, and the highest in the since Christmas was 580 meals a week, yeah. Cooked meals.
How long have you guys been doing this?
6-7 years.
Yeah.
Since we were like 6-7.
Yeah. Wow, yeah.
We were quite young, helping our moms.
So did you have to stop for a little while when COVID kind of took off, or did you guys just keep going?
We kept going, but we put in obviously the safety precautions for COVID, and right. we made the number of volunteers who come every week smaller, so there would be social distancing.
Wow, what are we doing here?
We are making 50 portions of pasta salad.
50 portions of pasta salad.
Do you want to get yours?
Oh, okay, all right. What do I need to do? Cut the cheese. I think I can handle that one,
yeah,
all right.
Okay.
And is there a particular meal that everybody enjoys? A curry,
rice,
maybe?
And
or?
Curry and rice, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
In the winter, I'd imagine it's nice, warm.
Yeah.
Warm everybody up, yeah.
It's sad, like that's kind of what keeps us going back to it. How can, yeah, you can never be happy having a full stomach knowing somebody else is out on the street hungry.
Very good, yeah, yeah.
You wouldn't believe it, but a lot of good has come out of COVID as well. Like people have, you know, bonded,
joined together, yes.
Bonded differently, like families have come closer.
Yes.
And, you know, people know each other, they reach out to each other.
So you've really been at the coalface of the whole thing, you know, you've seen it from the beginning right through and been out there doing work, which is absolutely amazing. As I said, I mean, this was the time that community really came to the fore, and we remembered that it's all about community.
It's all about just helping each other. I remember one call I got from a girl, she was from Tala, and she said, my name is blah, 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 blah. And she said, I'm not a Muslim, but can you help me? And I was like, of course I can help you. And I think in that year, as I said to you earlier when we were speaking, that's when I feel we won the hearts of the nation.
Yeah.
Because colour, creed, or race doesn't come into it then.
Yeah.
We are Muslim Sisters of Éire,
yeah.
But we're people.
Yeah.
And when you have someone looking for that, you know, the hand of help, your hand is going to go out and you're going to help that person no matter who they are.
Well, Muslim Sisters of Éire just sounds like a great name for a band, I thought. Is it okay?
The lead singer, yups! Muslim Sisters of Éire, I swear to God. Oh, stop, you're taking me back down that road. There's no Muslim Sisters of Éire band. We're a band of determined women.
Yes,
that's
full of empathy and charity.
That's what it's about. Yeah, full of love.
Stand my ground. I won't back down. Yeah, I know what's right. I got just one life in a world that keeps on dragging me around. I'm gonna stand my ground and I won't back down. Hey, baby, there ain't no easy way out. Hey, I'll stand my ground and I won't back down. Yeah, I know what's right. I got just one life in a world that keeps on pushing me around. I'm gonna stand my ground and I won't back down.
Hi everybody, thanks for staying tuned in and still catching up on your messages here. Thanks to Claire Leonard, brilliant interview. Thanks a million. Del Carroll, how you doing? Now my next guest has the grace of a swan, the wisdom of an owl and the eye of an eagle. I tell you, this man is frankly for the birds. Ladies and gentlemen, the amazing Keith Barry.
Well, that's the most interesting introduction I've ever had.
Thank you very much. I actually stole that one, but anyway, it's a homage to Norm MacDonald. Anyway, well, Keith, thanks for coming and joining us here for the bit of crack. So you, like me, had to learn all this, how to evolve and exist in cyberspace and to do shows online. How did you do it yourself or how did you work it out?
Yeah, so I suppose, like everybody, I had to kind of rethink everything that I did. So I started by just developing material that would work in the kind of online space. And, you know, I put one or two gigs on sale for the public. And luckily, they came in their droves to those gigs. And it was amazing. And then I was like, okay, well, what's the long-term vision of this? So I think, you know, I was talking to you earlier, I ended up working a lot for the corporates out there. So, you know, the Googles of this world, the Amazons, Dells, Microsofts, all these different companies for employee engagement, keynotes, motivational stuff. And I've been doing that for a long time, but it's kind of been kind of the quieter part of my business. Mm-hmm. So now, up until now, until we reopen, it's become the main part of my business for the last 18 months. So I've done that, wrote a book in the middle of the whole lockdown thing called Brain Hacks.
Brain Hacks, that's what it's called. Okay, yeah. When is that out?
It's out. It's on pre-order now, so you can get it on Easons, on bookstation.ie right now. But it's out physically on October 22nd. So it's basically tips and tricks for your subconscious mind to achieve the things that you want in life, you know?
I could do with some of that now.
Yeah, well, I'll give you a signed copy. But I don't have any copies myself yet. I'm dying to have a copy so I can have a look at it.
No, I actually caught one of your shows around Christmas, like the eve of Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
And I caught one of the Zoom shows where you had all the, you know, it was lovely because it was like all the families together on the, it was very moving, I thought, you know, it was just so lovely that you were finding a way for families to still go and be entertained somewhere, you know. It was really cool.
Yeah, but I did, like, in the kind of very early stages of it, when the hospitals were under pressure, actually, you know, I zoomed into the hospitals around Ireland. And that was actually really heartwarming just to see, you know, a handful of nurses. Like, I was literally it was literally like a handful of nurses on an iPad, mm-hmm. and they were trying to socially distance from each other, you know, in the confines of the hospital. And there could have maybe just been 10 of them there. And I did a lot of that at the start. And that was really heartwarming as well. But then the family ones was great because, like that, you know, even on Halloween, everybody kind of dressed up and came along.
Yeah.
And for the Christmas one, yeah, you could see that everybody was in the Christmas spirit. And you know, look, you know, you do what you can. And for me, I am that kind of positive mindset person. You know, I think you can control the things that are inside your mind. I'm reading a great book at the moment. I know I'm going off on a tangent here, but The Gift by Edith Eger. So she was in she's still alive, she's 94, and she was in a Nazi concentration mm-hmm. camp. But I read a great line in there yesterday, which really resonated with me. It was about escape the concentration camp of your own mind. And her whole ethos is you have a choice. You always have a choice to escape the concentration camp of your mind. And that really resonated with me. But that's the type of person that I am anyway. And that's why those kind of lines resonate with me and make me think that way, you know.
Every day is a beautiful day if you choose it to be so, really. Yeah,
absolutely.
And your new tour is called Reconnect.
Yeah, Reconnected. So
Reconnected.
Yeah, so that goes on sale this Friday at 9 a.m. on Ticketmaster. I'm really excited to get back on the road. Like, you know, it's in my DNA to be on the stage. Look, I love performing virtually. I love connecting with people. Writing the book was great fun, but by far where I feel alive is on a stage. I have to be on a stage. Like, you know, honestly, if people had no money, I'd do it for free. You know what I mean? I need to be on a stage. So with that being said, the tour Reconnected, it's on sale this Friday at 9 a.m. and I'm doing it pretty much every single city and town in Ireland, as many as I can get to.
Excellent.
So really excited about that. And I've developed some very interesting material. I came up with a routine where people in the audience are going to read each other's minds. So if you can imagine 500 people reading, if there's 1,000 people there, 500 people reading the other 500 people's minds in a really intimate moment to reconnect on a subconscious level. It's going to be a bit scary because they might find out some interesting information that the other party might not want to know.
I don't want to read anyone's mind. It's all right. Thanks very much. Are you going to do a trick for us? Are you going to do something?
Yeah. So I thought we'd get your audience involved.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought we'd make this kind of really interesting and reconnect with your audience. Right?
All right, Janice.
So I know you've got your phone there, so I'll set this up by saying, look, I've got a deck of cards here, but I want you to know that this is not a card trick.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what's interesting about this, and you'll understand what I mean in a moment. But there's a big black X here. The X is only here because we're doing this virtually. If all of the audience was here, I wouldn't even have that X there, and that will make sense in a moment. But I will tell you, there's one card flipped over. It's reversed. It's going the wrong way inside the deck. Now, it'd be interesting if I got you to think of a card, but I thought it'd be more interesting if your fans and your colleagues and your friends out there in cyberspace, if they started to type in playing cards at random into the comments on the Facebook.
Okay. And then, well, if everybody can start doing that now, we'll keep an eye on it here. We're 20-second delay or so. So get, if you can do that, folks, so keep going.
And as they do that, in a moment, you're going to select one of those people that for whatever reason you just feel connected to. And it doesn't have to be the first person that comes up. It can be anybody. But whenever you're happy with a person, you're going to go with their playing card. And let's see, can we try something interesting? So I suppose let's pose a question while we're waiting for all those to come through. Do you think it's possible for you to pick the one person out there? But do you think it's possible for you to pick the one person? And ignore the jokers. There's no jokers in this deck. But do you think it's possible for you to connect with the one person out there who will guess what the card is that's reversed in this deck?
Yeah.
Do you think it's possible? Oh, you do think it's possible.
Well, I don't know, but I'm trying to remember one of them here now. Well, I'm going to write it down on my own.
Oh, no, you can just name it out loud. You can name the person on the card if you've chosen somebody.
All right, hang on. You know what these things are like. Sophia Dave, the Seven of Clubs.
Sophia Dave, the Seven of Clubs. Now, here's the interesting thing. Later on tonight, when you're driving home, you'll wonder what would have happened if you'd changed her and the card to somebody else in their card. You'll wonder that. But later on, if you do change your mind, you'll regret that decision. Think about that deeply for a second. So here's the question. Do you want to change your mind or are you sticking with her?
I'm sticking with her.
So the Seven of Clubs, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, check this out. Look, inside here, I told you the X is important, and it is important because, Jack, I destroyed a deck of cards just coming here tonight. I put a big black X through all of the cards. You see, every single card has got a big black X going through it. Every single card. All of the cards, except one card is reversed. I saved only one card, Jack. The rest of them have that big black X going through them. So I put the X's through them so that you knew I didn't use any sleight of hand.
Wow.
I only put one card reversed, and you connected with the one person who chose.
No! Seven of Clubs. No. You're a devil child.
Thanks for not changing your mind to a different person, because that would have been really awkward for me, by the way.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah. If you think about it, it can't be done, so don't even think about it.
Yeah, but you have to explain it to me a little bit later on, maybe.
Yeah.
So that's pretty amazing. Have you anything else? Do you want to do one more?
Oh, yeah, sure. I thought we were going to save it for later, but let's do this now.
Okay.
Here's what I want you to do. Okay, I want you to think now of something that you've never drawn. So we've all drawn a house, a tree, and a car, and stuff like that. And have you a pen or a Sharpie or something that I can borrow?
Sure, yeah.
I'm going to draw on this, okay? I'm going to draw on this.
Sharpie, don't
you? Look at me. And yeah. Just whatever it is that you've never drawn, okay? You've got something in mind, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, close your eyes for a second and start to draw that inside your head now for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
But before you do, okay, you can open your eyes for a second, just for your audience to know, there's no way I could know this. You haven't told me what this is. This is just going to happen in your mind now. You're just going to draw it in your mind. Yes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, close your eyes. Start to draw it now inside your head. Good. You started to draw. Interesting. You started to draw a counterclockwise circle inside your head right there. That was a counterclockwise circle. And now you're adding some detail. Good. Continue to do that, Jack. Okay, I'll do this quite quickly. Good. Add in more detail. Yeah, that was kind of like triangles. I don't know what that means. Some kind of triangles. Good. Keep doing this over and over and over again. This is something, as a matter of fact, that I don't think most people out there would have drawn, perhaps at least not since childhood. So this would be a kind of a childhood drawing of some kind. Does that make sense to you, Jack?
Maybe.
Okay, good. Keep going inside your head. Now, I may have gotten this wrong. Open your eyes. Look at me. Close your eyes. Just add in just a slight bit more detail. Okay, I've drawn as best I can what I think was inside your head. Open up your eyes. I've no idea if this is right or wrong. Like, genuinely, I have no idea. Okay, name out loud. What were you drawing inside your head?
Outer space.
Sorry?
Outer space.
Outer space. So not like a truck.
No.
Did you draw it like that, Jack?
Oh!
Outer space. There it is right there.
Wow.
And that's not my art, by the way. That's Jack's art.
Wow.
From the inside of his head. I'm a much better artist than that.
I was scribbling, I was blacking it into.
There we go. Outer space.
Wow. That is truly amazing. Wow.
Here.
Thank you so much.
Put that underneath your pillow tonight. You know, I'll be there tomorrow morning.
Wow. That was truly magical.
The exact same drawing.
I'm hoping you'll stay with us here and we can chat for the rest of the show. In the meantime, I'm going to perform a little number I've prepared especially for you.
Oh, brilliant. Looking forward to it.
Let me go do that. And keep your messages coming, folks. Thanks a million.
Are we doing the exercises?
We are. Of course we are. We're going out here for a chat. I'm taking it easy on you. Don't worry. This is only a warm-up. And just slowly just roll the shoulders back. It's just nice and easy. And you're trying to stay alive. So we're just boxing out in front. Just nice and easy to begin with. Great stuff.
My hands and knees to pour it out just how I feel. I try to speak but I can't say a word. I know I'm growing old disgracefully. The spotlight's on, it's plain to see. You're like an angel glowing in the dark. So don't stop receiving signals loud and clear. Just start believing. There'll be magic days or magic ways. Magic days or magic ways. Magic days forevermore. Everybody knows your name, the good, the true, the beautiful. The vagabonds, the liars, and the thieves. You know you got so many pairs of shoes, but still you don't go anywhere. Just sit around counting broken dreams. So don't stop receiving the signals loud and clear. Just start. There'll be magic. magic days, oh, in magic ways. Magic days, oh, in magic ways. Magic days forevermore. Magic days forevermore. So don't stop receiving the signals loud and clear. Just start believing. Just start.
Amazing, well done.
Especially for you, Magic
Thanks.
Days.
It was brilliant.
Here's to Magic Days and many more of them for you. Everybody's, here I am, my eyesight is going. We're talking about our eyesight going.
Stop fighting, Jack, get them tested.
Caroline Wynn, how you doing? Karina White Byrne, I'm just naming out names here. Jason McSweeney, Mighty Stuff. Where's the Gig Pig?
The Gig Pig, hang on. Don't you have a bit of a gig announcement to make?
Yes, I do have a bit of a gig announcement to make.
I heard a rumour about you now. I have to find out if this is true or not.
Well, yeah. So basically, I haven't told anyone yet, but I'm playing the Three Arena next year. So yeah.
Wow.
So yeah, going to give the old Three Arena a bash.
Have you done that before? Have you done a full headline of
yourself? Point. I did it when it was The Point. Now it's the Three Arena. So people can... tickets are going on sale soon. I'll have more news of that. Just stay in touch here on Facebook and all the various places we stay in touch. Besides, during lockdown, did you learn any new, did you do Duolingo, new language, or what? How did you, I know you like the fish. I see you going fishing.
I'm like a crazy person with the fishing. So. Yeah. Did plenty of fishing. I tried trampolining for a minute, threw that out after like one set of trampolining, right. Like that. I didn't pick up any new skills as such, but spent plenty of time with the kids, which I think is important. You know, I think sometimes, not just entertainers, I think people in general actually don't stop to spend enough time with their kids. For me, especially during winter last year, we played tons and tons of board games with our kids, tons and tons of card games. So yeah, I learned some new card games actually.
All right.
I learned Shithead, I learned Split, Spit, I learned all these different card games, which were brilliant.
And it must have been mad to have stopped and be still like it was for me. As people say, it was the first time we got to meet ourselves, kind of just by, you know, because usually it's what's next.
But I think we're born to be on the road. But for me, I was always mindful of spending enough time with my family, and have been for like at least the kids are born, since the last 13 years. So I didn't necessarily need the downtime that other people needed. I love being on the go, but I love being on the go with my family and with my business.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I suppose once I got over the frustration of being locked up, then it was just about doing things that I haven't done for a couple of years. So like plenty of fishing, foraging. I love foraging with the kids as well. So we go out looking for mushrooms. We never find any. It's like fishing. I never catch a fish. I never find any mushrooms.
Yeah, well, I would think fishing is just an excuse to stand by a river.
Oh, it is. Oh, it is. No, you're right.
As much as foraging is an excuse to go into the forest.
No, but I chose fishing over golf because with golf, generally speaking, you know, it's like four or five people go together and play a game. But fishing for me is an excuse to be on my own.
Right.
And just stand there with my own thoughts.
Yeah.
And just empty the head.
Yeah. But yeah, reading the fish's minds and all that.
Yeah, we're just trying to find them so I can eat them, you know.
Are we going to do something with this Rubik's Cube?
Oh, we can. Yeah. You're a producer.
We're going to save that, aren't we? We're going to save that.
No, I think that's in the next segment. Time for another segment. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you what was
hang on. Stay tuned for the Rubik's Cube trick coming
yes,
up
indeed.
Soon. There you go.
You're going to just do the Rubik's Cube and complete it, isn't that right?
No, it took me 40 years to learn how to do one. You're doing it, not me.
Well, you'll be waiting another 40 years. What's the most dangerous trick you've ever done?
Do you know what? I've done a lot of danger effects over the years, like holding my breath underwater for 3.5 minutes as part of an escape and all these different things. But actually, I would still go back to 2006, which was the first time that I did a blindfold drive. And I did that going down a canyon road, completely blindfolded at about 60 miles an hour with Nicole Scherzinger from the Pussycat Dolls screaming her head off. She had no idea what was about to take place. And she had been blindfolded so she could examine the blindfolds. And she thought she was just there for like a quick trick. And then I took the blindfolds directly off her, put them on me, and then tore off at 60 miles an hour. But I remember at the end of that, with a production such as that, you know, you have to have a big team there. Mm-hmm. And the team that were there, you know, there were safety people and all the rest of it. And one of the guys came up to me and he said, you do realize you're about a centimeter from the edge of the canyon. And it wasn't supposed to be. So I was supposed to always stay about a foot this side of the canyon. But mm-hmm. I remember Nicole Scherzinger saying to me afterwards, she said she got so close to the cliff edge, she could have just spit off the cliff edge. So that was probably the most dangerous because, like, you know, if you miss a beat there, you're going off a canyon and you're dying. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, but I've done a lot of day. I'm full of injuries from all the dangers.
But if the eyesight is getting bad, at least you've done that anyway.
I could do it again. Yeah. The eyesight's getting worse. Like hanging upside down from a crane 250 foot in the air with myself, locked in a straitjacket with cling film wrapped around my head, probably wasn't the smartest thing that I've ever done either, you know.
You're an adrenaline junkie like myself, yeah.
I like all these things, yeah.
Thanks, Keith. Let me see now. Another one of, we're going back to The Wheels and the charity. Another one of The Wheels' partners is Age and Opportunity. And I got to meet Paul and witness firsthand some of the extraordinary things that they're doing to help those at risk of isolation and in isolation. Well, I'm here with Paul Galliel. Do I put a bit of a French twang on that, Paul?
You can if you want, and a wee bit of Donegal maybe at the end.
Donegal French, I like it. You're with Age and Opportunity. Can you tell us what Age and Opportunity is, maybe?
Just we're a national development organisation, and our main aim is to improve and maintain the quality of life of people as they get older.
Right.
And we would mainly work with people aged 50 to 100 plus.
Right, yeah. And how long have you been involved?
I've been involved myself now since January 2019, so just over 2.5 years. We always aim towards what's called functional fitness. And functional fitness for an older person, they have it, and mm-hmm. will enable them to be independent and healthier for longer.
Maintain movement and
maintain
keep the blood flowing, yeah.
Activities of daily living, you know, something that we would take for granted, such as, you know, standing up out of a chair or opening mm-hmm. the door. So very, very simple movements,
yes.
And we kind of repeat those and with kind of different pieces of household equipment too.
And they've all learned how to use the stuff online as well, which is amazing.
We've been blown away by the reception, to be honest, now, because like
fantastic.
Many people, as it was before COVID, we would have thought, you know, that maybe older people would be a bit wary of technology. Mm-hmm. But they've really, really embraced it, which has kind of helped our classes then as well. The classes are very, very short now. And what we try to include a kind of a social element at the start. So people will come on, you know, we'll have a little chat, the pop-up comments, mm-hmm. so that they can feel that they're in a sort of a community, albeit a virtual one as well.
Yeah.
We'll do our movements maybe for 15 or 20 minutes. And one thing that we purposely do, we don't mention COVID. You know, even for that 15, 20 minutes, it's just a break.
Yeah.
Because at the start, and even during the middle of COVID, you know, it was in the news, it was in the media, it was in the papers. So it's just a break. We chat about everything and anything. Don't mention the C word.
So I believe you're doing a class today.
I am indeed. And if you want to join me, we're going to jump online now and do it on Zoom.
I'll see you online. Let's do it.
Cheers.
Well, to go easy now, because Jack's not as fit as you now, so you just go easy. Go easy on him.
Are we doing the exercises?
We are, of course we are. We're not here for a chat. And just slowly just roll the shoulders back. It's just nice and easy. So as we're marching on the squat, we're moving the arms. That's it. And we're going to step in, just stepping side to side. And you're trying to stay aligned. And we're just boxing out in front. It's nice and easy to begin with. Great stuff. I think if the three of us were in the ring with Kelly now, we'd make it a chance. I wouldn't fancy being one-on-one with her. So that's round one. We survived all the round now. Jack, you're looking a wee bit tired there.
You said this was easy.
I know. Right.
So we're going around two, so there's two of them now in the ring.
And how long have you been using Age of Opportunity?
I think maybe two years, maybe.
And were you using it before COVID?
Yes, well, I was. We were in the gym in Inspire before all the COVID hit. And then we went online with Paul. And we've been doing that with Paul movements. I think it must be a year and a half now.
But a year and a half now, Jerry, yeah, we can all go away.
Isn't it? You know, I can't say enough for Paul what he's done for nearly all of us that go online on the Monday, Tuesday, and Friday.
Did you find it hard to learn how to use the technology, or was it come easy to you?
Well, it's not too bad now with this. Like, you know what I mean? I'm not the greatest on top of technology. I'd rather be in the gym, meeting people, and socialising. I think with Paul there a while back, we had a talk. People just were talking to each other. We weren't doing any classes, as far as I know. Which is great to know, like what I'm doing now with you, talking to people. You know, we did a little talk there, I think. People got to know each other and that, yapping and that, you know, talking. So that was great. So the technology and online stuff, really, for everybody now with the COVID has been a great, especially people who might feel isolated or don't have any family or support like that. And this is a great idea, you know.
The best bit of feedback that we got was, you know, when, as Jerry said, things were turned upside down, there was a lot of uncertainty for people. You know, the nicest thing that we heard back was that it actually gave people a reason to get up in the morning. You know, it gave them structure.
Yeah, I think it's just something to anchor your day to or your week.
Anchor,
to.
That was the word, actually. Anchor was the word that we used,
Something to look forward to.
Yeah, I think the whole pandemic made us realise how much we need to talk and be in some kind of community.
Yes.
You know, it's only you took it for granted because it's just natural. But yeah, it's such an important thing, and to be getting a little bit fit on top of that is fantastic as well. So thanks to Paul and thanks to you guys, and I'll feel this tomorrow, I think.
Excellent. Well, I'm just reading some comments here. Thomas Quinn just put his shoulder out doing the exercise. Sorry here, Thomas. Keep it up. Exercise is amazing at any age. Leslie, Wren. Biggest thing I missed were hugs. Human contact is so crucial. Sending you all a big fat squeezes this evening. That's brilliant to hear. Katrina McCormack. Look how big Derek's grown. He used to be tiny. That's a joke because Derek used to be always in my phone when I was doing the live streams before. Mr. Derek Cronin playing piano with me there. Welcome back, Derek, in real life. You sing the sound of our souls. I don't have a name on that one. Roll on the Spirit Store in October. You know, the Spirit Store gig in Dundalk, I have had since 2019. It was sold out. Wow. It's just been moved.
Yeah.
So I'm finally getting to do it. And you know, because it's all out, you couldn't do it because the numbers, you know, it was too many people to get into the,
right.
When you couldn't get enough people in. Nothing beats face-to-face interaction between people, especially people who care for each other. Anne-Marie McGregor. Thanks a million, Anne-Marie. So good. There are people out there to help and be good to each other. Danielle, thanks so much, folks. Keep the comments coming and keep sending your postcards. We're probably going to set up maybe during the week we put up whatever ones maybe also. We'll maybe have a different Facebook page where you can put up if you send any videos or things like that. But meanwhile...
Rubik's Cube.
You going to do the Rubik's Cube?
So, do you know how many variations and algorithms there are to a Rubik's Cube?
No.
Well, most people would, right?
I didn't even think about that.
So there's 43 quintillion variations. Wow. Rubik's Cube. So what that means is if you were to turn the cube one turn per second, that's obviously 60 turns per minute. That's 3,600 turns per hour. That's 86,400 turns per day. Now, what that means is, if I was to turn the cube one turn per second since before time even began, since before the Big Bang, like, I still would not have turned that 43 quintillion times. But the interesting thing is, every cube can actually be solved in less than 20 moves, even though there's 43 quintillion algorithms. And when Erno Rubik invented these, it actually took him a full month to solve it himself. The guy who invented it, right? So it took me 40 years to learn how to solve it. But I thought, well, first of all, you mix it up for me. Go ahead, take it, mix it up.
It's like, mixing a pack of cards.
Yeah, well, don't worry. There's just, like, I suppose a couple of hundred people examining your mixing ability right now. And I bet you were the type of kid when you're trying to solve one.
We just
younger.
Took the stickers off and changed them around. That's all we did.
Some people out there would be the same.
We hadn't the time.
So here's the, we were too busy on BMXs, wasn't it, our day. Yeah. So look, I'm examining this, and I'm going to tell you that this can be solved in about five moves. Five moves, and that will be fully solved, okay? But they need to be exact. Now, do you believe you could solve that right now?
No. See, I'm not good at them.
No, I believe in you, Jack.
I have no patience.
No, but I believe in you. You don't need patience. You just need intuition.
And intellect.
An intellect and intuition. So here's the idea. Take it.
Right.
Now, if you try and solve that now, I don't think you would do it. But I believe that you can do it. So put it behind your back, okay? With two hands, okay? So here's the idea. I want you to make one move now. Just any move that you like. You're going to amaze yourself when this happens. Okay, now you can revolve it around if you need to, and then make a second move. In other words, make a second twist.
Okay,
now make a third twist. Now, when he solves this, we want a gigantic reaction on Facebook. We want everybody sharing this afterwards. We want everybody commenting. Fourth move. I want you all telling people that Jack L tapped into his intellect and intuition and solved the cube. Okay, and one move left. Fifth move. Okay, are you confident in your abilities?
No.
43 quintillion variations. Five moves, Jack. Let's take a look. Oh, hang on. Slightly awkward. You do know it means to get all the colors.
Yes, of course, yeah.
Oh, wait. Have you ever heard of preconscious processing?
Preconscious
processing.
Processing.
Preconscious processing is the processing of information through your peripheral vision. Mm-hmm. You see, there's a second cube on the table. It's been there the whole time, isolated underneath that glass. Okay. Now, be honest. Did you even notice this other cube sitting there underneath the glass?
I did notice it there, yes.
Okay,
but
here's the crazy thing.
I noticed there were two.
Jack, you're not going to believe this. You matched one side of my cube. Now, the odds of that happening are 43 quintillion times 43 quintillion, Jack. That's the odds of that happening. But you didn't just match one side. Jack, check this out. You matched two sides. Jack, you didn't just match two sides. Jack, you actually matched three sides. Jack, you didn't just match three sides. Jack, you matched four sides and five sides and six sides. That's 43 quintillion times 43 quintillion times 40. Jack, you're an absolute genius.
Wow. Stunning.
How you did it? We'll never, ever know.
Absolutely amazing. God, okay. I have to sit down and think about that one.
Yeah. It'll take a lot of thinking.
About all the tricks you've done, I'm blown away, absolutely blown away. Yeah, that's stunning, yeah. I want to ask you, in all your traveling in the darker recesses of the mind and all the different things you've done, have you ever had any ghostly experiences?
Well, that's an interesting question that I'm not sure I've ever shared. So I've conjured a lot of ghosts in seances that I've done in the past, but of course that's always under my control and tapping into people's subconscious, so I'm not really sure if that's contacting the other side, because I'm not really the jury is out, shall we say, on that. But there was one experience that I had that I can't actually explain. So it was when my grandfather on my mother's side, he was ill in hospital, and he'd been there for a while, and I remember just waking up one night in the middle of the night, and I'd been crying in my sleep, which has never happened to me before. It's never happened to me since. I was crying in my sleep, and I woke up and I just went, Gaga, we used to call him. I just went, Gaga's dead, he's died. And I just went back to sleep. And then my mother came in the next morning, and she came in and I said, I know, Gaga died at 2:07 a.m. last night. And she went, how do you know? I said, I just know. So that was the one moment that I was like, I still don't understand to this very day. So sometimes I like, as the scientist in me likes to put things down to, you know, oh, maybe it was a coincidence or whatever, but that one thing freaked me out, being honest.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people have those kind of experiences.
It was a lovely day. I quite enjoy the mystery of it. Yeah. I quite enjoy the fact that I don't have all the answers, and I don't want to have all the answers either. Do you know what I mean?
Same as, it's the mystery that keeps me going. Yeah,
yeah, I don't need to know why we're here. I don't need to know if there's something out there. I just need to be present in the moment, and I'm very happy to do that. And I'm inquisitive and curious, and I think it's important to be inquisitive and curious. Absolutely.
I think believe everything and believe nothing, you know?
Yeah, yeah, you know.
In a positive way.
And embrace everybody and everything, you know, like-minded, positive people.
Yeah.
You know, when I say everything and everything, I mean, you know, just people who are good people. And I suppose it's just important to always have empathy for other people. You know, we hear that.
And, I mean, that's what COVID taught us. We all actually need each other. We really do, you know?
But I think that needs to continue now. And I think people that's need the to thing. Remind
themselves.
Well,
that's themselves. What this show is about. It's kind of trying to harness that thing that, you know, we all thought, oh, yeah, we're going to change our lives, and people are slowing down. And things are slowly moving back to the way they were. And we just need to remember that about community and how important it is, and how important it is to slow down a bit and to spend time with your family and all those kind of things that we forgot as we... In a consumerist kind of thing, we keep moving on the whole time.
Oh, yeah, I could very happily be a minimalist. You've just hit on something there now, consumerist.
That'll be your next book.
If Mairead is listening or watching, my wife, we've got to minimalise. Just get rid of all the clutter out of the house.
Yeah, I did a little bit of that myself,
the
actually.
Stuff needs to go. I'd encourage everybody to do that. Just declutter and get
rid of
stuff.
Yeah, no, it's good for you, all right, yeah. Okay, sorry, I better read a few of these. This one is from Diane Gibbons in the UK, her hubby Mike entertaining the neighbours for the Thursday night NHS clapping. So I released an album streamed, which is the best of the lockdown sessions. And so you've obviously spent the time devising the new show. That was that a lot of what you've been doing in this time?
Yeah, but we were talking, like, you know, I obviously wrote the book. I find that kind of writing really hard, but creatively writing my live show, it doesn't come easy to me, but I really enjoy that process. And I don't know when you're writing your album or not, whether you bounce ideas off other musicians, but I've got a couple of core friends that I really trust. When I say friends who are also mentalists and magicians and hypnotists.
Right, yeah.
So I go to them and I go, what do you think of this idea? Where I get the whole audience to read each other's minds, and I get excited by that. And then I say, okay, the show's called Reconnected. So imagine if we took two people who open up to us in the audience and say, well, actually, they found it hard to connect during COVID. And what if I reconnected them mentally on stage, and where I physically touch one person on the shoulder here, but the person over there with their eyes closed, they feel that touch and reconnecting people. So, yeah, I mean, for me, that's what I spent the time doing, just, you know, delving into what reconnection is. And I think it's time for us all to reconnect.
Absolutely.
Humanly now, though. You know, this is all fantastic. And look, we're blessed to have this. But I think you're like me. You want to be on stage and just be in the presence of people now, you know?
Most definitely. There's not, we can do what we like online, but there's nothing like the real thing. So thanks to everybody for watching. I'm just trying to catch up on it all here. Helen Crowley, thanks a million. Big shout out to Kate Purcell, who's 21. Big shout out to John Horan, who's ill at the moment. Get well soon. And now I'm going to run next door. But first, I want to hear from you. This is how you can send your postcards from the edge.
Hi, this is Jack Lukeman, and I'm looking for your pandemic stories for my new web show, Postcards from the Edge. Please send me your poems, songs, messages, videos, or even just a request digitally. Tag your content online with hashtag JackLPostcards, or send a message to any of the accounts shown here.
To post your postcards free of charge, send them to Postcards from the Edge, P.O. Box 13420, Free Post, FDN 7530, Dublin 2.
Frankie ain't swinging, the king he sounds dry. Songs that once moved me leave me paralyzed. Since you left me, baby, the birds forgot how to fly. Since you left me, baby, you can't tell my left from my right. Since you left me, baby, the music's out of time. But I keep dancing. sound, just like we used to do. Keep dancing, yeah. Keep on your dancing shoes, keep dancing. Waltz right through these blues. Same and brothers and sisters, I ain't singing. Keep drowning in all this rain. Since you left me, baby, the flowers, they no longer bloom. Since you left me, baby, I can't tell the sun from the moon. Since you left me, baby, the world sings, but it sings the strangest tune. And I keep dancing, just like we used to do. Keep dancing, kick on those dancing shoes. Keep dancing, just like we used to do. Keep dancing, waltz right through. Just keep on dancing, and there's nothing left to do. Kick on your dancing shoes. Kick on your dancing shoes. Just keep on dancing when there's nothing left to do. Kick on your dancing shoes.
Aaron, that's getting hot box and selling coffee out of a nice and let's go please. Let's go for bees in a horse box. It's where my whole brain is just focused on listening to the bees.
Yeah.
But we arrived here literally 1 week before the lockdown measure started. Most of this experience has been under COVID, so.
Keep dancing, that's all we can do, folks. Keep dancing. That's the motto for our current time.
I haven't had a good dance in years. I'm ready for a dance.
Now's your chance, yeah?
Yeah.
You were bopping away there. Hi to Mags Frost. Pat Malloy Coggins, how you doing? Some great old friends here. Fantastic evening. Wonderful entertainment, Molly Kavanagh. Great show, full of heart. Sounding great, Jack. Mary and Pat Maloney. Thanks so much, folks. Thanks, and please share this with your friends as you can on Facebook and everything. And I suppose we better wrap things up. We're gone over the hour, and we'll be back next week, of course. Thanks to Keith for coming along tonight, and as always, a pleasure to hang out with you. Next week, we are going to be talking about pastimes, the things we did to get us through lockdown. So please send on your comments and your texts, and remember the hashtag is hashtag Jack L Postcards, so then I can find them on all the different mediums. So also thanks to Another Avenue for putting this together, and Sarah and Claire from The Wheel. Thanks to Martin and Mikey and Susan and Steve and everybody. And so I'm going to run next door and finish this off. I'm going to read all these comments later on, so keep them coming, folks. And maybe you can read a few of the comments.
Yeah, love to. While I've got a few postcards over here.
A few postcards from the edge. In the meantime, folks, good night. Thanks for tuning in and watching. Keep spreading the word. Keep positive. Keep dancing. And I'll see you all next week at 8 o'clock on Facebook Live and on jacklukeman.com. Thank you so much.
Well done, Jack.
Cheers.
So this is from Alan, who says, "Hi, Jack. Learning how to play golf with a broken leg, nonetheless. It was always going to be a challenge, so well done to you, Alan, for learning how to play golf with a broken leg." Somebody here, it's an anonymous postcard that we have here. "I never had faith in myself, but I do after COVID." So isn't that a lovely thing that somebody actually found faith in themselves during COVID? "I watched a lot of cricket during lockdown and still don't understand the rules, but I do find it relaxing and weird." That comes from David. Well, isn't that interesting? Somebody who actually finds cricket entertaining. But I do believe we have a very good cricket team here in Ireland. A few different ones here. We got somebody who says they're thankful for the music and the magic as well. That's from Anne-Marie MacGee. "Greetings from Spain, Jack," from Robbie Kelly out there. So thank you to Robbie. It says, "Mags from Huntington, watching from the hotel that they booked for your cancelled gig, Jack." So Mags is watching out there. And somebody says, "Finally, live again," from Linda. I think that's Budin or Bondin there. So thank you for all your postcards. And I'll hand you back for one last song from Jack.
Take the world off your shoulders, little man, little man, little man. Yeah, the young are getting older, little man, little man, little man. Halcyon days, my friends, lost in the trees, do you remember it? Halcyon days, my friends, we're just flowing down this stream. You're released, return into your dreams. You're released, we're just flowing down this stream. We're just flowing down this stream. Take the world off your shoulders, little man, little man, little man. Yeah, the young are getting older, little man, little man, little man. Hey! I'm lost in some haze again, from women to the sun. I've been lost in some haze, my friends, but it don't last long. You're released, return into your dreams. You're released, we're just flowing down the stream. We're just flowing down this stream. All together now, take the shoulders.
Yeah. Oh.
Our plague across this land. Dogs just keep on barking, it echoes across the dew. I still stood here wondering, oh, if I should follow you. Deeper down the rabbit hole, deeper down the rabbit hole, deeper down the rabbit hole we go again. Deeper down the rabbit hole, deeper down the rabbit hole, deeper down the rabbit hole we go. Walking, kingfishers and dragonflies floating through the air, snails kiss upon a cherry, but lady birds just stay. How come you always go where the roads never leave? Till it's good.